This is a proof that I've got a background in computer science. I'm the only speaker who's brought a computer to try and talk from. I didn't bring a PowerPoint, so you'll be relieved. So I guess today we expected the misinformation bill may not have been defeated by this point. So we're talking really about something that probably is not going to happen, but might have happened. But it's worth beginning with the story of the last 2 months. It was a very bold move for the Albanese government to try and relaunch it. After last year, they received 20,000 submissions in a 55-day consultation period. This time, they tried to sneak this through. They tried an 11-day consultation period. But we knocked up a little bit of a tool where people just fill out a form, say which bits they were not happy with, and over 25,000 submissions were generated using our tool. There were emails for people to send. Now, we don't know if everyone sent those emails in, but we were not the only people doing it. And the Senate committee has only put up 104, as of today's date, of all the submissions that were made. They haven't even put our submission up. So they're very busy. The Labour chair of that committee is very busy hiding all the submissions on the misinformation bill. But if I were a betting man, I would be guessing that most of the submissions will be greatly exceed the number that we received first time round, and most of them will have something important to say. If, you know, the misinformation bill's website has got misinformation on it, that tells you something about the misinformation bill. And I'm going to talk about this from, I guess, both angles. My background is as a computer scientist, but I also want to talk about it from free speech. And I want to talk about first what the bill means or would have meant if it was passed. And second, I'll talk about the other bills. So this is a campaign. The misinformation bill is one of many bills that the Albanese government is trying to get through at the same time. It could even have been a sacrificial lamb. There isn't much attention being given to the other bills, the so-called privacy bill, the hate speech bill. Now, there's a bit more attention being given to the age censorship bill, or whatever they want to call it, keeping kids off social media. But this may be a smokescreen. But it's still very important that we managed to stop the misinformation bill. So most people won't have actually read the misinformation bill itself. But the legal effect of it was quite simple. ACMA, where the eSafety Commissioner is based, they are one and the same, they think the same, they operate the same, subject to any legal challenge, could issue some codes. And those codes would decide what social media companies would do. So what would have happened is there'd be a pile of litigation. So the bill was in some respects symbolic, but that understates it considerably. Because what we've learned from the eSafety Commissioner is actually how regulation takes place outside the law. So the Online Safety Act says any attempt by the eSafety Commissioner to issue a notice to a tech company, you have the right of appeal. Well, the eSafety Commissioner says, sorry, these are not real notices. We're just telling them to do it. We're not ordering them to do it. And believe it or not, these social media companies comply. Most of the time. And not just social media companies. We're talking about GoDaddy even. GoDaddy have been taking down websites on the encouragement of the eSafety Commissioner. And they tell us that these notices cannot be appealed. Now, most people never find out. Of course, the only thing you find out is that your content has been taken down. That is all you find out, right? Or your account's been taken down. You never know the eSafety Commissioner is involved. But one of these leaked out, and we have a case where we're challenging this notice. And on December the 13th next month, we'll have a hearing in the Administrative Appeals Tribunal before the President and two of the most senior members of that tribunal, which the eSafety Commissioner was trying to stop. They were actually fighting a proposal to have a hearing about this. And either way, we win or lose, whether it will decide whether these notices can be challenged. And if these notices cannot be challenged, then I imagine there will be some very scathing commentary from the tribunal saying how this is inappropriate. If they can be challenged, then the eSafety Commissioner is in a lot of trouble. But it's the mode of regulation. So the misinformation bill, let's suppose it passed. What would happen is the tech companies would comply with the message being sent by the misinformation bill. They would be censoring content left, right, and centre, apart from X. They would be censoring content left, right, and centre based on what they think the government may want them to censor. So that is what the bill would have done. That's not what the legislation said, but that's what the bill would have done. And that was what's so worrying about the bill. So what you'd have had is enforcement without law on a bigger scale than the eSafety Commissioner. We would be having these private companies censoring on behalf of the Australian government what the Australian government, they think the Australian government wants to censor. And if that is not chilling and worrying, I don't know what is. But it goes deeper, right? This collateral enforcement model, there's that. But it's also the message it sends. It's to our allies, potentially it damages relationships after Trump's election. To potential migrants, I mean, it basically says, well, we don't really believe in Western values. We're just, you know, pretending to believe in Western values. Not good for the sort of migrants we may want to bring in, and not so good for Australia as a country. But also to wider society. It tells, you know, employers when we pass things like, for example, you know, we say academic freedom's supposed to exist in universities and they know it's to be humid. That's the message it sends. It's the wider message that this bill sends. And so that was the main potential damage of the misinformation bill. Thankfully, it's probably dead. Thanks to all the campaign that's been done by organisations such as ourselves, but also many other organisations who, and not to say the least, also individuals who have gone to the effort of saying, this is not on, this is appalling, this is not what we want in our society. Thankfully, it's been defeated. But this is the beginning, not the end. This is the beginning of our fight. We have, as I mentioned, other bills coming. They will try and sneak in censorship provisions elsewhere. This is what they want to do. They want to censor it. They want to control what can be said. So I'm going to go through three of the nasty bills that are coming up. The first one is the so-called privacy bill, which has just left the committee in the Senate. It may even be voted on and passed. Privacy sounds nice and cuddly, doesn't it? You know, it sounds like something there to protect people, something about people's rights. And, you know, you might think of the GDPR. The GDPR actually is, on the whole, a pro-free speech provision. Lots of free speech campaigners have used it to find out attempts at censorship. So in Europe, if someone takes down your post, you can get a copy using all the correspondence involving that attempt to take down your post or any complaints that were made by making a subject access request with your own name on. In Australia, we don't have that. We can't make any requests whatsoever. So yeah, you think about privacy and you think, hang on, this is going to be a good thing. This is going to be good for our rights. Well, then you look at the contents of the bill. And one of their provisions is a criminal offence of up to 7 years imprisonment, what they call doxing. And doxing sounds terrible. It's what they call doxing is the problem. They define doxing in such a way that includes any personal information about another person that disclosing it may, I guess, distress them. So that could be where Dan Andrews plays golf. That could be stating the fact that Roxanne Tickle is a biological man originally called Jason. It could be all sorts of things. None of these things that you'd think were doxing. They've written something that's incredibly expansive. It has no safeguards in it. And this can be selectively enforced. And most of these things, you know, if you're thinking about doxing, you'd think someone's, your physical address, where you live, right? That's perfectly legitimate to stop people broadcasting online, right? But things like email addresses, well, put a spam filter on. Putting someone's email address up, sending someone's email address. I mean, seriously, that could potentially get you 7 years in prison? Really? Or someone's social media account details, or someone's phone number. I mean, you can, if people don't want to hear things, they can block it out. It's not hard, right? So these sort of things, it's trivial. It's not doxing. Or facts about people. We're not talking, yeah, the things that are actually serious invasions of privacy, they're already stopped by other laws. You know, if you want to do things that are odious, like putting up revenge porn or whatever, there are sensible criminal offences that already deal with this. This just covers anything. And that is the problem. It's open-ended. Personal information, well, that could be, you know, whether I've got blue eyes, how long my hair is, whether I'm bald or not, et cetera, et cetera. It could be anything, right? And they're hoping this is one of the things they were sneaking through. And if you doubt the risk, think about what's just happened recently in the UK, where I'm from. They have been locking people up for tweeting. For example, tweeting views that are probably very ill-advised and sort of things you shouldn't be saying, like, you know, burning people for having particular view, you know, for being migrants. Of course, it's awful, right? But these are people's views, and the best approach towards doing it was counter-speak. Then when you look at the sentencing remarks in the UK, they talk about, oh, it was viewed by, you know, 300,000 people. It's like, well, do these judges understand how social media works? Well, no, they obviously don't. I mean, the only reason it's been reviewed by 3,000 people is because someone sat there retweeting, liking, right? So they're basically putting this whole bunch of responsibility. Now, you might accidentally put someone's number on Facebook or whatever or something like that, and it's a chilling effect, right? You need to think every time you put a post, if this passes up, that the government might, you know, selectively enforce it and use it to send, you know, potentially bring a prosecution against you. No, yeah, sure, you might be able to defend it in court. You probably will succeed if it's a ridiculous prosecution, but again, the process is the punishment, and it will be used selectively against certain people. If you've got gender critical views, on the other hand, you know, if this passes, then you should be quite concerned. And that's not the only bill that you should be concerned about. But this will be used to elevate what is someone being a fool into a criminal offence. It's people being fools online. You know, people are fools online. That's life. It isn't something that the law should be criminalising. And it's got very little to do with privacy. I mean, if you want to actually put effective privacy provisions in that stop people's email addresses being broadcast, or, you know, stop people's home addresses being broadcast, that's something the platform can do. You know, if they really want to legislate that. It doesn't require criminal law, doesn't require any of this stuff. And it is designed to be a tool of censorship. So this is the thing, the misinformation bill. It's one target, right, that we've focused on so far, but there are others. I'm going to take the next one. This is before a committee in the Senate. It's a hate speech bill. And it does two things. It adds, you know, more offences and expanded ones, and it also lowers the threshold to be convicted. So they've taken away most of the defences. They've made it a very subjective test from what was previously objective. So, you know, something that you could actually, let's say you read, you know, you took a total joke online and someone found it threatening, then potentially, you know, that could be identified as hate speech in the wrong circumstances. And allegedly, this has been watered down. That's what the story is. That's why it's not had so much attention. But it is still nasty. And it also includes symbols. So, you know, if you wore a t-shirt saying, you know, woman, adult human female, well, depending on how the bill is interpreted, a legal case could be made saying that that is criminal hate speech. Not talking civil, we're talking criminal. So this is the thing that Labour have done, right? There's been all these fireworks around the misinformation bill whilst these other two bills were progressing. Then there's the age verification bill, which isn't before Parliament yet. This wasn't something that Labour originally planned. This was originally started in South Australia, and then it sort of escalated, so it wasn't part of the original campaign. It's equally as odious. We haven't seen the contents of it, but we know what it's likely to contain, because it's based in part on a review conducted by Robert French, made for South Australia. He's definitely not a very helpful person for free speech. I can tell you that, having worked in the university sector. They hide behind the French review as a means of pretending to have academic freedom, where he found no problems. He's written a bill that makes absolutely no sense whatsoever, which is the good news. So if it is the test that he passes in this bill, it will be the same one that was used in the Bishop stabbing case. Namely, they have to take all reasonable steps, reasonable being an operative word. And the court held that banning VPNs was not a reasonable step. So again, it's going to be the same thing here. But if it includes effective steps, then you're going to have a generalized digital ID system, because the focus is on websites like social media companies. I mean, they might be dressed up as apps or whatever you want to call it, but basically they are websites. And yeah, there is an issue obviously around parental control, but that doesn't need to be addressed by having digital ID or age. You know, put parental controls on the devices in software. This is not hard. You know, there's free providers. There's Apple, there's Microsoft, and there's Android. Android, they can make it available to parents themselves because it's open source, if that's what they want to do. So then you've got Apple and Microsoft. And parents, you know, if they want to buy their kids an expensive phone, they can sure put the parental control software on if they want. So the only thing is about facilitating parents who want to have parental control software on their phones. This is not hard. It's a completely different issue. It doesn't involve age verification. It doesn't involve any of these nasties. But, and it could be just they're completely ignorant and uninformed. The worst thing about this, as I've been mentioned earlier, the Uni Party are pursuing it. This is being pursued both by the Liberals and it's being pursued by Labour. And this is maybe out of ignorance. We don't know. They may just produce something that has absolutely no effect whatsoever. We will see. But the fact that they think, you know, they want to become world-leading again in internet censorship in this bill, which will be another embarrassment, at least to Australian society, as a minimum. It will, at worst, embarrass us. At best, will embarrass us. And at worst, it will be another severe attack on our liberties and digital freedoms. So, those are the three bills. Where are we? So, the misinformation bill has almost certainly been defeated. That's a landmark. That is something for us to celebrate. But at the same time, we have a big battle ahead against all sides of politics. We have the age verification, we have privacy, we have hate speech. So this is not going away. There are attempts to attack our online and in-person freedoms of speech and freedom of expression. They continue to might make a mockery of our digital rights. The Liberals might be less bad next time around. We hope for that. But this is still going to be a lot of work, regardless of the outcome of the next election. And so I guess I just want to finish. We, the Free Speech Union, we've got a lot on our plate, and it'd be fantastic for anyone interested to come and join us and help us with this fight. Thank you so much.